Right there, you're looking at Alita Borja, our main female character, and she is flipping through her script. She's reading her script right there. But you may be fooled to think that she's writing in a catalog or maybe taking inventory for the shot, but no, she's actually reading the lines from the script.
Right. And something we incorporated in the beginning of that scene, she's flipping the pen. And we just saw her doing that while we were setting up the shot. And we thought it would be a cool thing to add for, yes, production value. Yeah. So, I mean, coming from a no-budget, micro-budget standpoint, anything and everything that you can incorporate into your film that will add somewhat of a larger production value, the better. The more you can do it, the better.
Yep. And for more DIY behind the scenes, the clothes that this character Imo-san Masakatsu, which is Dion Lozama, is wearing is actually my shorts. Those are my shorts. So, you know, it's really micro budget to no budget at all.
Yeah, the reason why we did that is just to show him that he's on Guam, you know, to reclaim what he thinks is rightfully his, but he's also having fun while he's here.
Yep. Just visually compelling shots.
Yeah,
is and, what and our emphasis was.
Thanks to Joe McCarroll for that great song too. Yep. Ah, the racetrack.
Mm-hmm. So here's a local racetrack we had some access to. Actually, to be exact, it was 3 hours because
Ed Cruz.
Yeah, Ed Cruz actually volunteered his time to just open the gates for us, and we just gathered people who we knew that had race cars to come and race. Actually, that's Kel's brother-in-law's
brother.
Yeah.
Yep. And we ran this race probably about 5 or 6 times just to get enough coverage to make the shot look at least impactful and fast, make the race believable.
Yep.
More production value.
Yep.
Yeah. Roscoe, great friend of mine.
And also the captain of that boat.
Yeah, the captain of the ship. He has a couple of boats, and at that time he had that one Boston Whaler, so... he said, yeah, let's use it. We asked him, no problem at all.
Yep. So, you know, just utilizing what resources were available to us. And funny thing is, you know, my character was supposed to have come fishing, but there's no fish, you know. But anything to raise the production value, so we said, how about a couple fishing rods? You know, maybe the fish is in the cooler behind me. Nobody knows those details, so you don't have to overthink it. Another thing is, and you know, I hate to mention it, but it's you know, one of those continuity things that if you're good, you'll catch it. But I'm actually dubbing over Abel Inocencio's character, which is the racetrack guy's character, him.
That is Abel playing the character of Bong.
Yep, Abel Inocencio playing the character of Bong, but I'm dubbing it because he was unavailable to dub it while we're making the last minute changes to the movie.
Yeah, something also too, we'll get to that too in the audio ADR
portion
of our behind the scenes commentary, but it was low budget. We did not have the luxury of having a boom operator with us. It was literally just Don and myself.
Yep.
And then if some of the cast members were there hanging around, we'd ask them to help and, you know.
But we didn't have any external audio source, like a mic source. We always used internal microphones. So if you ever notice when there is dialogue being exchanged, it's always up close. It's never far. I mean, we have one scene that's far, and that'd be the last time we attempt something like that without a boom mic or a boom operator or lavalier mics.
And here you hear, I think, for the first time, the score, the theme of the movie is that lone acoustic guitar. Don actually had to teach himself how to play guitar to score the movie.
I wouldn't call it playing, but, you know, just some type of original music to add on to help the vibe along.
And here, this was Lotus Surf Shop, but upstairs they run a seafood bar and grill restaurant as well.
So this scene, we shot the exact same time, or not the exact same time, but the same day that we shot the introduction scene of these two characters.
Yeah. It did take us 2 days to shoot this short scene, however, because the first time we shot it...
It rained.
Yeah, it just rained all over it, so... We had to cut and wait for the next day.
Yeah. One good tip is just to bring your little, iPhone or something to take pictures for continuity. You know, you want to stay away from continuity errors. Because these were shot on separate days, we had to make sure that, you know, Alita's flower was on the right side of her head, that Matt was still wearing the necklace. Just little things like that.
And also, too, one thing that was always driving us crazy, but it was something that we just couldn't help at the time, was the addition of extras in a scene. As you know, you might notice when you watch the movie, whenever there's a dialogue scene going on, there are hardly any extras around.
Actually, zero extras.
Yeah, because we had basically bare bones, just Matt and Alita ready to go and do their scene. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so we just focused all the attention and all the composition around them and their dialogue. However, if you can get extras, use them, because they make a world of difference.
Yeah, they add. This is a very intimate scene, shot. Basically, and this happens everywhere in the world, I'm pretty sure, but at crash sites, they have a little memorial set up where people will, pass away after... a devastating or fatal accident. So what we did was we literally did pay respects to a memorial here, and that's why I think it's a really touching and believable scene. You can just totally tell that their mindset was there, really paying respect. And it's just one of those things, not to be disrespectful or anything, but one of those things where you can utilize reality, get into the mindset of what can be real and believable for the performers, and try to push them there to help them achieve your direction.
And with the island landscape here, it's just beautiful. We showed up and turned the cameras on. We did a few visual effects, but nothing too compromising to the scene. This is the Inarahan pool. Just a beautiful day, and it was almost too beautiful. There weren't any clouds in the sky. We'll cover that in our special effects section. But
yeah, but the point being is that if you have any access to great landscape or to
something unique in your hometown, that no other place has,
use it, because it brings so much production value. And just by chance, Matt was willing to jump into the little lagoon there, and we thought, hey, what the hell? And so did he, apparently.
He's a hasher.
Yep, and that was just a one take.
Yes, great production value here. Was one of the local community center's baseball fields in Aganya Heights. And wow, this scene took us, not because we wanted to, but because we had to shoot it within the course of 5 nights.
Mm-hmm. And it was all due to continuity. So like I mentioned earlier, you know, take some pictures right before you you roll camera, so you know what you may or may not be missing within your character's wardrobe or makeup.
The first night we shot it,
I was utilizing the cane. This is the first night. Now, this is like the fourth or fifth night, all because I didn't have a cane. I was supposed to walk with a limp or something, and a cane, just to add, you know, some type of dynamic to my character.
The hard part about it was we shot the entire scene, and then we were packing up the production truck to go. We were asking each other, do you have the cane? No, I thought you brought it.
Yeah.
We just realized we shot the whole scene without the cane, which wasn't going to work.
Yep.
There are two things in my life. And so this is our little tip of the hat to Peter Berg and Friday Night Lights, which was a real big influence in our production around 2007.
Yep. Another thing, going back to DIY production, it was just by chance that we came across this location because, like a quarter mile away, Nick, that character that you saw on the screen, the big guy, he lives just right up the hill from Aganya Heights, and we saw lights on at the baseball field.
And the issue with us was, how are we going to light up a night scene? This has to be a night scene. And while we were standing around thinking about it, we saw the glow of the baseball field. We go, aha, that's it. Go there.
Yeah, so we're literally improvising the day of, the moment of the shoot.
Right.
And thank goodness to the local baseball teams for playing all throughout the week, because if they didn't, we'd be out of a night scene.
And that's something very crucial, too, is that as a DIY filmmaker or somebody going into it with very little money, you have to be able to compromise your vision to get it done.
Yeah.
As much as you don't want to, I think it also helps nurture your creativity, because you're forced in a position to make something out of what you may think at the time is nothing.
Mm-hmm. Make use of it. Right here is a funny thing, is the language that they're speaking here is our native language, Chamorro. I am not fluent in Chamorro. I don't even speak a little bit of Chamorro. So what I had was paper plates with the Chamorro language written down, the lines that I needed to read. And for those that are fluent in Chamorro can tell that I'm not fluent.
But yeah, for that shot.
But I was reading
on the ground. Yeah, were just four or five paper plates with the Chamorro dialogue on it.
Yep. So for instance, I would look down to my left and there would be the first line. Then I would look off to the right for my second mark, and then would be the second paper plate, and I would deliver the next line, and so on. And Julius actually didn't have that much of a problem because he's Saipanese, and he in Saipanese they're known to be fluent in Chamorro, and he was really good at the language. Here's a great scene. This scene was actually shot in L.A.
This pickup scene.
Yeah, this pickup scene was shot in our driveway.
So this right here, the exteriors are all on Guam. You cut back to Vince in the interior of his car or his SUV, and that pickup scene was done outside of our place in L.A. because we needed it.
Yep.
Right there.
Yep. So I'm in a Highlander car. It's a totally different car from this car.
From the Land Cruiser there.
Exactly. And it's seamless. I mean, nobody will be able to tell the difference. Protect their loved ones from the dangers that the truth can uncover.
Oh, yeah. Another great point about production value, too, and utilizing things that are unique in your neighborhood or your hometown. There's this great abandoned theater, which is right there. And we figured it would just be kind of fun.
Yeah, just cool, basically.
Yeah.
Cool to just showcase a landmark or something that, you know, your community can relate to or be able to see and say, wow, hey, you know, I remember watching movies there, or hey, you know, that's right behind my house.
Yep. Here's something I want to touch on, too. Because Don was acting in this scene, that only left me to get all the shots and all the coverage. So we replayed this scene numerous, numerous times, only to get the different types of coverage. So you see this shot set up. It'll cut to that shot set up. It'll cut back to his over the shoulder. So we would replay the scene numerous times. We got that interior shot of inside the cab of his car. So it's the different types of coverage that will sell it to
Make it seem like you have
five camera setup.
Yeah, when in actuality you just have a one camera
one
setup.
Guy one you tired know. Guy
Again, we were working around our resources, and we're I hate to use the word restricted, but, you know, there was somewhat of a, you know, an area which we could not work out of, which was our budgetary, issue.